ready for the Mind Dog, the magnificent show!
And welcome, my friends, to another episode of the Mind Dog TV podcast. I'm Matt Napo. Thanks for coming. It's great to have you here, as always. We tend to think here in the United States that the world revolves around us. And I know that for the rest of the world, that's got to be annoying as hell. And there is so much that we don't, in this country, we don't really know about the rest of the world and the cultures and the geography and all of it. We just kind of pay attention to the United States of America as if it's the only thing. And the attitudes that we have in this country, yet we're number one, has to piss off the rest of the world, because when clearly not number one in a lot of areas. That's my first point about it. But also just the total bullshit bravado that is part of American culture. And so I'm kind of curious about that. My guest today is from Wales. Never been there. I know a lot of people from the UK, and I've been to England, and I know most people in America think Wales is England. And they also think Ireland is England and Scotland is England. This is how out of touch with the reality of the world outside of us that we are. My guest today is, like me, a Doug Stanhope fan. He's a comedian. He's a guy who was found me through the Doug Stanhope appearance on the podcast on YouTube, and we became friends on Facebook. I saw that he was a comedian. I watched a clip of his from a club, and I thought, wow, that would be cool to have somebody from Wales on as guest, a comedian, learn about the culture of comedy where he's from and find out how it's different from our world, and really just get some insight into his comedy, the kind of stuff he does, and whether or not the struggles for comedians trying to make a name for themselves are the same across the pond as they are here. So without further ado, please open your ears, open your minds, open your hearts, and will help me welcome in the fabulous Jamie Dykes. Jamie, welcome to the Mind Dog TV podcast. It's great to have you here.
Thanks for having me on, man. Much appreciated.
So Wales, tell me a little bit about Wales, because most people, like I said in the intro here, people don't have a clue what Wales is. They just think, you know, Prince of Wales. I know that that's an English guy, right? The Prince of Wales. So what is different about where you lived in England?
I'd probably say to start with, I think we've got a lot more culture than they have in England anyway. I think England thrives on its old school, you know, we are English and we are British and that's that. But yeah. Down in the South Wales Valleys where I'm from, it's a big go-get-em attitude at the moment. You know, it's a lot going on as well, especially on the comedy scene. It's a renaissance of comedy in the South Wales Valleys. Cardiff, my city down the road from me, it's comedy scene's booming at the moment, really big. It's going really strong as well. But it was up until COVID-19 decided to piss everyone off.
Right. So the comedy situation over there, and I noticed that you're having a little bit of ale air, is that what that is?
Yeah, it's a stellar Artois. I don't know if we can brand on this podcast in particular, but you know,
that's fine. I'm all for it. By the way, for the YouTube censors out there, it's not a paid endorsement, not paid placement. We're just having a drink.
That's great. What are you drinking? What's tea, coffee?
It's actually iced tea with a little bit of Jameson in it.
Nice. I was going with Jameson's and lemonade. I might have one in a bit, actually, but who knows?
Yeah, it's day drinking for me. It's 3 o'clock here. I know it's evening over there, but so it's really not. It's frowned upon. Day drinking is frowned upon.
This household, is not. Not in this podcast either.
You know what? I love about your comedy is that you don't hold back from the truth. Or telling the truth that you feel and worry about. It doesn't seem to me that you worry about cancel culture or what people are going to think about it or pissing off the wrong people. Yeah. You just say what you think is funny and let it let it sit. And I think that that's kind of lost, at least over here it is. I don't know if, the, again, I don't know the culture there, but here people walk on eggshells with comedy now. Talk about your outlook on just delivering your comedy as without concern of censorship.
I think it just simply comes down to, you know, no compromise. If you've got an idea in your mind when it comes to standing up and stay on a stage in front of a group of people, that microphone for 3 minutes, 5 minutes, or 10 minutes, that's yours. You know, I swallow words and I regurgitate the words out into the general public. If I get laughed back, brilliant. If I get some boos, fantastic. There's one thing worse than a boo or a heckle is probably dead silence.
Right.
So I tend to say whatever I think is funny. I've got a small group of comic friends as well. You know, we do the same sort of circuit time to time. And a few of us are the same. You know, we'll say what we want to say. We tend to get pulled up from time to time, or at least I have in the past. I've had someone come up to me, one of the organizers of a comedy event, and they've said, you shouldn't really joke about this. So my response was, well, why? And the joke wasn't about taking the fun of this individual. If you listen to the joke properly, it was about taking the piss out of the individual's mother. And, you know, you could argue the case of this person was collateral damage, but it's, you know, it's comedy. You know, it's Frankie Ball, Scott, you know, Frankie Ball, Scottish comic.
Yeah. Yeah.
He said once, he said, what is it about comedy that brings out the worst in people? And I just think that's a phenomenal thing to say about comedy. It does bring out the worst in a lot of people. You shouldn't say this.
Well, you're younger than me. You're younger than me by quite a bit. I think you're my son's age. You're probably in the early 30s, right? Or mid 30s, somewhere around there.
30, 34 now, yeah.
Yeah, my son was born in 86, I think. But it didn't always used to be that way, which is the point I was going to make, is that when I was growing up, people were more apt to enjoy comedy, even if it didn't agree with their political views. Like, a lot of conservatives love George Carlin. A lot of conservatives even love Dick Gregory. I'm not sure if you know who that was, but he's a radical black guy, comedian in the U.S. in the 60s and 70s. But you could enjoy people's comedy, even though they were on the opposite spectrum from where you were. And that seems to have gone away in the last 20 years or so, where politics is so divisive that people, you know, if your comedy is to the left and I'm on the right, I hate you. And if your comedy is on the right and I'm on the left, I hate you. And it's a shame for comedy in general, because I think it's hard for a comedian to write and know where the lines are sometimes. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, 100%. Yeah, I totally agree with that. The lot of the guys you mentioned, I haven't heard of, but obviously George Carlin, I know of because my father's a fan of George Carlin.
Yeah, you seem to know a lot of. I was just looking over your Twitter page earlier today. You seem to know a lot of American comedians. Yeah. I would bet you $1,000 right now that nobody in America knows a Welsh comedian until this moment.
I probably wouldn't put a bet on that. It's probably a few, but no, you're right. I don't think there is. I don't think there's a lot of people in America who got a general understanding of not Welsh culture as such, but Welsh, let's just say, arts, for example. There's a lot of great bands in Wales. There's a few comedians on the up and rise as well. We're not famous for our stand-up comedy, you know, but hey, if I can get my name out there, not in the sense of self-promotion, but just to have a look in the back garden of England and say, oh, look, there's a little dot on the map called Wales as well. Turns out that's not England. And it'd just be nice to get people to have a little insight as to what, you know, what we get up to, you know?
Yeah. And you had sent me a clip of some of your work from a YouTube clip. And I actually had found that one earlier in the day and looked at it. And I will be sharing that with my audience. Is there other stuff online? Because I've had a difficult time finding any kind of performance stuff of you online.
Yeah, a lot of it's down to like laziness, like me not filming a lot of stuff or the gigs that I do. My partner's got some stuff she's filmed. I think we share it on groups on WhatsApp. I think I put one or two things on Facebook, but I don't know why. I just don't. I haven't really gone into the self-publicizing thing. not for any fear that I'm going to get ridiculed or, you know, shut down for the stuff that I do. Just this is something that I don't actively do for some reason, but I'm going to get on it. You know, I'm going to.
Well, a lot of stand-up guys I know don't do it because they're afraid of exposing their material. If I overexpose my material, then when people come to see me, it'll be stuff they've already heard before, and they don't want to put too much stuff online or on YouTube for that reason. Is that a concern or not?
No, not a concern at all. It's purely probably a born out of laziness. You know, wake up in the morning, go to work, come home, see the family, do a couple of gigs as and when I can. Yeah, so a lot of the stuff I've done has been filmed. It's just not great recordings, but it's just a case of getting it together and getting it out there, I suppose, really.
Right.
But I can send you some stuff. I can send you some stuff, and I'm gonna self-publicize more. I have a bit more faith in myself as well.
Yeah, I think if you want to be more successful, I think that's kind of important.
Yeah, of course.
Over here, comedians have to really, really struggle to even get paid, even once. And musicians, not the same. I'm a musician, and I've done stand-up, I've done comedy, but the comedy world is brutal in what it takes to make it. Is it the same over there? Do you have to work open mics for nothing, do 3 minutes at a time constantly, and never get paid until years go by when they call you and are ready to pay you? Is the culture of the business of comedy the same over there?
Well, I've been in comedy for just shy of a year. So that clip you saw, that was my first comedy stand-up. That was in the Glee Club in Cardiff. But to answer your question, yeah, it's quite ruthless. I mean, you've got, you know, a lot of people wanting to get on the same stage, do the same stage time as you. So someone may say, for example, I'm doing a gig, I want, you know, 5-6 comics, but you know, 20-30 people might say, yeah, I'm interested, I'm game, I want on that. And then if you're too late to get in there on Facebook or, you know, Twitter or whatever, then you've lost the spot. But yeah, it's cutthroat, man. I think I've done two paid gigs, but the rest I've done have just been like open mic gigs, 5-10 minutes. Some bars or clubs you go to may offer a free beer or two, which is nice, it's great. Get to meet people, but it's ruthless, you know.
Yeah,
a lot of people got the same idea. Let's get out there. But
and it seems again, it's so much different than the music world. The music world just cares about if you're good, you come, you get paid, you make a contract for the gig, you play the show. But in comedy, they almost expect you to pay to play. In other words, you got to bring your family and friends. You have to fill up their room enough times before they'll even consider paying you. And it seems a strange model for the arts, because there's nothing else I can think of that works quite that brutally for the artist. And it's frustrating to see that, because I think we lose out on a lot of great possible comedy, you know, stuff that's really new.
Yeah, I love to do comedy as a full-time gig, but the fact just under shy of a year, like I said, I've been doing comedy now and I've been paid twice. You're talking 20, 30 quid for a gig, you know. It's fun to do it anyway, but it'd be nice to do it as a living. Right. But I think it's kind of like any mainstream bit of entertainment you want to get involved in. You do music, as you said, as well. You might get, you know, a couple of dollars from your end for a gig. It's a saturated market, I suppose. It's just the point I'm trying to get at.
Right. A lot of what, and again, I'm just going on by what I know from the U.S. and much other place. But here, a lot of bookings for young comedians or beginning comedians is depending on their social media following. So a club will look at you. They don't care how funny you are or not funny you are. If you have enough Twitter followers, if you have enough Facebook followers, you can get a headlining gig. And that makes no sense at all, because a lot of these people aren't funny in any way. They just have a lot of friends and know how to use social media. Is it the same there?
I don't think it's as extreme as that, based on the places I've been. But I've been to a few places where you've got to take friends or family along. They have to pay for a ticket to get in. You're talking 4 or 5 quid or whatever the amount is. And then it's a room full of people, a huge audience of people. And you've got 10 comics or so doing their bits on stage, and then no comic gets, you know, a penny of that money. So all the money then just goes to the club or the organizer or however they work it. So in some senses, yes, the same, but I haven't experienced how ruthless it is to the bare bones of it yet, so to speak, you know?
Yeah.
But I am aware that it is, it's cutthroat. You know, I do know a few older comics who've been doing it for many years. And so they pretty much would agree with what you're saying as far as it goes, the comparisons with the States, then to right. answer your question, I suppose, yeah, it would be.
Yeah. So who are some of your, I don't want to say influences because that's such a cliche word, but who are your favorite comics right now that are working right now, famous comics that are?
Well, as I mentioned earlier on, as a Frankie Boyle, he's a Scottish comedian, absolutely outstanding. In fact, Doug Stanhope was on one of his TV shows a few years back, which was fun. But yeah, obviously you've got Frankie Boyle, we've got Doug Stanhope as well, who is my grace and savior. Dave Chappelle, he's...
Yeah, I agree. Dave is top of the charts for me too. He's up there.
I love Bill Burr as well. You got Bill Burr.
All right.
I also love Andy Andrist as well. He's Doug Stanhope's mate. But he's outstanding. He's absolutely phenomenal.
Yeah, I'm hoping to get Stanhope on again. I haven't known about him for that long, actually, because he's so censorable that TV won't have anything to do with him here. He did host the Man Show for 2 years, but they clipped his balls pretty hard and didn't let him really be Doug Stanhope on the Man Show. But other than that, he can't really get TV exposure here because he's so, you know, edgy. It doesn't even come close to describe what he is. He's balls to the wall, in your face. Yeah. This is my truth. Take it or leave it. And that's what I love about him. But it's so controversial that a lot of people don't know him, even though he's considered by most one of the top comedians, and he sells out rooms. Doesn't have the TV exposure, so I didn't know of him until 8 months ago now. And I'm hoping to get him back on, but I'm also hoping to get a friend of his, Tom Kanapka, who was
Tom Kanapka from the podcast
and Tom, as well. Yeah. Right, and Tom actually was there for Doug's very first try at stand up comedy in 29 years ago.
So
I think he's got a book to write himself. I mean, about old Vegas and all that kind of stuff. But
yeah, he's got some wonderful story to tell. Did you when Doug Stanhope done his first book? I think it was Digging at Mother.
Yeah.
He met up with some of his old pals, and Tom Kanapka was one of them. And that's the first time I heard of Tom Kanapka, like a lot of people.
Right.
And him and Stanhope were just basically on the audio book of Digging at Mother. They were just talking about the good old days, and it was great. Like, I think it was more of a podcast. But he was going there to see Tom Kanapka about the old days, and it was an amazing podcast. And then, lo and behold, shortly after, Tom Kanapka decides to move to Bisbee, Arizona, with Stanhope. And
You know what, Stanhope, for a guy who is anti-religion, he's almost got his own religion happening.
Yeah.
He's got a cult following.
The killer termites. The killer termites. I suppose, what's the term? Comedian, is he? That's the correct term, I think it is.
Yeah.
He's got a phenomenal following. Like, in down South Wales, on the comedy scene, which I do, he's known. You know, he's known. And if people didn't know him, they know him now through me.
Right.
So, you know, you're welcome, Doug. It's fine. I suppose you could say my love of his comedy is kind of an obsession. It's like I said, it's cult-like. In fact, when I only joined Twitter to follow Doug Stanhope after I saw him back in 2013. And I think I said something on there along the lines of, if Doug Stanhope started a religion, I would definitely join. So it's, you're spot on there, yeah.
What kind of subject matter do you riff about when you're all over the place? You do religion, politics, everything, family. I noticed a lot of family stuff, I think, in the one clip, if I remember right. You were talking about your kids and stuff. But above that, what's your topic?
I don't have a specific choice of topic as such, but I say topical. I think every bit of comedy that is done is observational and topical at some point. But I've done little bits and pieces on, you know, politics of the day, or thrown in a little bit about religion. Nothing too extreme. I was struggling for an opening joke going early start this year. I was struggling for an opening joke. I had a gig on the Thursday, Wednesday or the Thursday. This was a Monday morning. And I was on my way to work on the bus, and I saw on the news that Kobe Bryant died in a helicopter crash. And we got the BBC, and they basically advertised, you know, Kobe Bryant, NBA basketball player, dies in a helicopter crash. But they advertised it with a picture of LeBron James, which was, okay, so they don't look nothing like each other, okay? They're both, you know, tall black dudes, and they both play basketball. So I just thought to myself, well, to my knowledge, you know, you can't get them confused, because to my knowledge, LeBron James, you know, never raped anyone, allegedly.
Oh.
So I said, oh, there's my opening joke. So it's kind of topical, but then a lot of the jokes I got are probably, you know, good on the Monday, but no good for the following Monday, because it's old news.
Right.
But, I've got a couple of bits and pieces I wrote down, you know, weeks ago, months ago, which will fit in with something I may write tomorrow. And, you know, I'm always digging through bits of paper or going through my phone to see what I recorded when I was pissed up a few weeks back or something. But things always fit together, you know. Something's always relevant, and I've always got something written down that makes no sense but may make sense if something tragic happens on the news. So it's whatever pops up on the news, I suppose. But I topical, observational, like I said. But I think that's in everyone's part of comedy, to be honest with you. But I don't think any topic's off subject anyway, so I'm happy to discuss and say whatever I think is relevant and funny to myself, you know? I'm out there to make people laugh, not make people cry, but if someone cries, it's better that than they do nothing at all. I'd rather see some emotion from the audience, you know?
Right. I read a line that you wrote on Twitter this morning, and I think it was this morning, might have been yesterday, but I read it this morning. It was about Boris Johnson and going full Ron White. And there was another English politician or UK politician that I don't even know who he is, but the line was funny in itself, and going to full Ron White and the line that came after it. The question is, really, do you use Twitter? Cause I know Mark Norman, who's a up-and-coming comic here, he uses Twitter kind of to try out new material to see what kind of response it gets.
Okay.
And he's always writing jokes and putting it out there on Twitter, and just to kind of get a feel for what's going to work and what's not going to work. Do you do that?
I do. I mainly put it on Facebook. I do use Twitter, but I find Facebook, you know, I get a lot more likes and thumbs up and laughing emojis, ha ha ha, and a lot more comments. But I think with Twitter, I think it's fucking ruthless. Right, it's really hard to get one or two likes. Facebook, you can put something up, you can say something, and you may get like 20, 30 likes and a lot of comments. You'd be lucky to get one like and maybe a share a week or so down the line on Twitter. But so to answer your question, I do that via social media. I put the feelers out for certain jokes.
Yeah, you know what? I'm going to start sharing your stuff, because I laughed out loud at that one this morning, and I'm sure there's other stuff in there. I know Twitter can be, because it's so fucking political, it's so divided politically, it's ridiculous. But about 2 months ago, I guess, I started to say, you know what, unfollow all these people that are talking about politics and just stick with comedians, musicians, and filmmakers and people I like. And all of a sudden, the world changed and started to become a better place in a lot of ways. Because I think fellow comedians are more tolerant of other people's disagreements with them. Just if something is funny, it's funny, whether it's conservative or liberal or however you want to label it. Something is funny, it's funny, and that's not always the case with non-comedians. So I think, you know, having more of those people in my circle, I'm starting to notice that it's not as brutal as it used to be with all the political hacks. So what, you know, what are your plans for the future? You're still in lockdown over there or not? Or
we still in lockdown. I think we've got slight different rules, because you got the UK government, which is Boris Johnson and his band of merry arseholes. They're running the UK as a whole. But we're lucky. We've got like devolved nations. So you've got Scotland, Northern Ireland, and Wales. We've got our own governments, if you like, so to speak.
Right.
So we have taken a different route to the English sort of coming out of lockdown, which is a lot more gradual process. But yeah, so we are still under lockdown.
How much longer?
Well, they've lifted restrictions. So like last Monday, they said we can, you know, meet other people from another household. You know, really, which is nice because, you know, and then they said, you know, you can have someone from another household come to your back garden. You can socialize in your garden. So it's nice to have, like, for example, my mother pops over with my sister, or my brother will pop up with his wife and his kid. And so that's good.
I thought our stuff was bad, but we never had a rule where you couldn't have people over your house. It was mostly gatherings in public places. But we've had, you know, everybody's had family and stuff over here for the most part, if they didn't have to travel. Traveling sucks. You know, you got to get on a plane and wear a mask for 4 hours or something while you're flying. That's insane. But we have what we call phase two happening tomorrow, where they're opening up restaurants for outdoor dining, which means musicians like me can start to probably get back to work soon and perform in outdoor venues for however long the summer lasts. But we'll see how that goes. But with all the riots that have been happening over here in the last 2 weeks, I think the rate of new cases is going up again. So that might throw a whole.
Well, that's the concern over this end as well. We've obviously the riots they've gone from where they started off your part, your neck of the woods. They traveled all the way down to, our way. London is a, you know, 2-3 hour drive from where I live, but it kicked off from there over the weekend as well. The last few days we had riot. We had a protest in Caerphilly, which is my local town. Nothing to brag about. It was a peaceful protest, but in London though, it was fucking carnage. You know.
What about and you don't have to worry about offending me. I promise you, because I'm not a nationalist. What about the outlook from abroad, I mean outside of the U.S., about our attitude that the whole world revolves around us and this attitude that we're always number one and kind of bragging about? Does that piss you off?
To a point, it depends on who your president is. I mean, you had Obama, who was kind of a cool, relaxed, chilled out guy. He came to this country when we was going through the initial, or just before the Brexit vote.
Right.
And he came over, he just sort of weighed in. He was a bit, my personal opinion is you should stay, you know, but it's not my country. I don't get to vote. You do what you want to do. But now on the flip side, you've got Lord Trump, who's basically dictating that, you know, the UK, you should leave the EU, right, and you should leave now, and you should leave on American terms. It's like, oh, hang on. I mean, I voted to remain in the EU. It was a sensible fucking option. But that aside, but you got someone like Trump then basically saying, yeah, you should leave, and you should leave on our terms, and we want a chunk of your NHS and take our chlorinated chicken while you fucking at it too. But I think with, I mean, America, as far as, you know, a country goes, I've never been there. I love to go there. I think a lot of the people are great. But when you're on holidays, you know, you go abroad, you can always hear the Americans a mile away.
Right, yeah.
Very loud. But I got nothing against Americans whatsoever. I haven't really met enough of you to have a
form. I think you have to separate people from their country. So individuals, yeah. I have no problem with anybody from anywhere. Some countries piss me off. Yeah. But I think as an American, some of the stuff the country does astonishes me. Now, you mentioned Trump going over to the UK and telling people what they should do. And a lot of people in America support that our president should go to another country and tell them what they should do. If that happened, if somebody from the UK, if Boris Johnson came here and tried to tell us what we should be doing, they'd be ready to kill him in a second.
Yeah, they probably would. And you know what? Fucking rightly so. You wouldn't understand a word that comes out of that guy's fucking mouth. He mumbles and stumbles so much. It's incredible.
How did he get Well, I should. I know how Trump got it. It just, you know, populism and backlash against everything that was left.
The exact same thing. It was the exact same thing when Johnson got voted in just before Christmas. You know, it was all on the base of a simple slogan, which was, you know, get Brexit done. And that was those three words were the brainchild of this guy, Dominic Cummings, who I referenced.
Oh, right. That's the guy. Yeah, okay.
He's the chief political advisor. He's not a politician. He's just the chief political advisor, you know?
Right. He's like Steve Bannon was to Trump.
Yeah, it's you know, it's essentially sort of his government. That's the general sense is that from people like myself.
Yeah.
But it's a lot happened over the last couple of years in the political landscape. It's not boring, but it's fucking scary. I tell you that much. No,
right? You're scary. I was just going to ask you: are you optimistic or for the future? I know you got kids, and it's got to be rough to be a parent and look at the future and say, you know what? I feel comfortable about the world I'm leaving my children. And I know you're not leaving anytime soon. You're a young man, but it's got to be a little nerve wracking or anxiety driven to kind of think about where the world is going for your kids. No,
yeah, it's anxiety driven to a point. But again, I mean, I am 34. I was 21 when I had my first child, so the world wasn't really in a much better place than it is now. Yeah, since my oldest, she's 13 years of age, and it was a lot of bad shit going on then. It was a short while before, you know, my wife fell pregnant that we knew it was a bit of a fucking shit tip to be living in the first place. But, you know, lo and behold, we decided to do the naughty without the relevant protection, and she came along. And then a few years later, we done the same thing again, and we had another kid. So, but it's their mess now. We created the mess. They can clean it up when we're gone.
Oh, my God.
you're right. It's the future's not looking great, but I suppose everyone's got to keep a little bit of optimism. I mean, if we live all pessimistic, then we're all just going to go in our own personal lockdowns and retreat for the rest of our lives and die of loneliness and boredom, which sounds great to some people, but the reality is it's not. I do worry. It's a natural concern as a parent, I suppose. But
you say your oldest is 13. Does she get your comedy?
You cut out there. What was that, sorry?
I said, you say your oldest is 13. Does she get your comedy? Does she appreciate your sense of humor and get it?
She's 13, yeah. Well, that clip I sent you of me in the Glee Club in Cardiff, my brother filmed it on the night that I did the gig. And like a day later, I was a bit, shall I show her? So we showed her, and she laughed, but she wasn't too enthusiastic about my use of language. She doesn't swear. It's, you know, my daughter's 13, my boy's 9, and it's a very open, comical household. There's certain topics which we got to stay away from because of that age, but yeah, they understand, they get it, and they're picking up a bit of a twisted warp sense of humor as well. So who knows, maybe I'm shaping up the next best comics in the world. Who knows? It's start somewhere.
You mentioned that you've only been doing it for a year. How long have you wanted to do it? Was it something you always wanted to do? Did you always think, you know what, that someday I'm going to do stand-up comedy?
Funny enough, no. I've liked comedy since I was a kid. Like I mentioned my father's a George Carlin fan. But when I was really young, my father used to watch a program we have over here called Have I Got News For You? It's like a political sample TV show. Great fucking show. I used to watch it all the time. I used to think, ha ha, that's funny. I used to watch little programs, Harry Enfield and chums, Hale and Pace, comedy sketches, not really for like young kids, but I think that's what got me into the fascination of just absurd, a bit twisted, a bit of a warp comedy. But it was literally a few years ago. My daughter's 13, so she was, you know, 10 then. I was on YouTube and something popped up about what was it? It was atheist jokes. It was comics on there, like Ricky Gervais, Frankie Boyle, a few other comics, like Bill Burr was on there too. And then that's when I first heard about Doug Stanhope, was on this YouTube compilation of comics doing jokes about atheism. Then I thought, oh, great, comedy's brilliant. And that's where it got me into comedy. And about, I'd say, 2 years I'd been wanting to do stand-up comedy for.
Huh. Well, I've always, and I say this quite often, in the creative arts, stand-up comedy is the bravest thing that you can do as a creative artist, because you're getting up there just yourself, almost naked, with a microphone and nothing else. As a musician, I can always hide behind a guitar. Guys can hide behind a drum set. Even the singer has his bandmates with him that he feels like are kind of a tribe against the world, you know. But when you're up there alone, it's kind of a lonely place, and knowing that the pressure's on you to make somebody laugh, it's a very brave thing, and it's not for everybody. So were you at all nervous, scared about it when you first tried it?
Oh, fuck yeah. I was really, really nervous. Well, building up to the my first gig at the Glee, I only done it because a friend of mine sent me a link, and basically was there's a company called Ultra Comedy, or they do various different things, but this one was called Ultra Comedy. So the idea was, it was a free 8-week quote unquote comedy training school.
Right.
And then the end game then was you would get to perform in the Glee Club. So I filled up the form, I went for it, and ultimately it's all about raising money for Cancer Research UK. Obviously, that company gets a nice slice of the pie, but a chunk of the money goes to cancer research as well. So I thought, yeah, fuck it, try my hand at comedy. They ain't going to like my brand of comedy, I suppose, but we'll give it a go. So we had 8 weeks preparation time with a local comic, which was great. But yeah, walking or waiting to go onto the stage while the last comic was finishing up in front of 400 or 500 people, my asshole fell out about 3 times backstage. And I literally, the first 10, 15 seconds when you see me walk on stage, and I got my bottle of beer, and I'm like, I'm touching the mic stand. I literally fucking forgot what I was doing, why I was there. I had no idea the next words that were going to come out of my mouth. So that's why you hear me start off going, yeah, fuck yeah, how's it going? Happy fucking days, blah, 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 blah. I just literally thought, buy yourself time. Don't do nothing stupid. Just swear and hold your beer and just work things out.
I think everybody who's ever been in the creative arts can relate to that moment. The first time you step on stage and I forgot my shit.
As a musician, do you ever like learn a new song or original stuff and you think,
oh,
fuck.
Oh, yeah, sure. I think every time we do something new, that because my band has never had a rehearsal. We've been together 20 years and we never had a rehearsal. So basically take the song home and learn it, and then come back and we'll do it on a gig. And there are times where I feel like I know it pretty well. I practiced it at home, and then I get there and I say, God, I don't fucking remember how it even starts. How do we start this again? Yeah. And then, and I'll look at the drummer and I'll say, how do we start this? And he'll be, I don't know.
1, 2, 3, 4.
It's like, I'm not sure we should do it. But before you know it, you're doing it anyway, and you're just going to find your way through it. And so that happens a lot. Yeah. But there have been times, you know, I've never smoked out of a vape pen in my life, or getting high vape pen. And one time I was on a gig, it was several years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, and somebody said, you should try this stuff. It's not like smoking pot. It's you don't cough, whatever. And it didn't feel like it was working for me. I tried this thing. I said, I'm not getting anything. I just kept doing it. And then it was time. I put it down, and I heard 1, 2, 3, 4, meaning the show's starting. Yeah. And I was like, for a good 3 songs, I was just like a total idiot. I never played guitar before.
Yeah.
I was like, I don't think I could do this.
Just seeing things and
yeah. So, but yeah, I mean, every time you go up with a new piece of material, you're kind of a little bit nervous about it.
Fresh, but I go back to what you said about, comics, essentially naked on stage, musicians got a guitar and a drum kit in front of them. And they're like, I suppose our sort of shielding, touching on what you said previous, was like, it's kind of going on Twitter or Facebook, social media, throwing the feelers out. And if you get a couple of likes and a few ha-has, then that joke's kind of golden. You can sort of put it to one side.
Right.
I suppose that's our, to a point, that's our sort of, a barrier between the audience is social media, I suppose. It's just my observation of what you said earlier, that's all.
It's interesting. You mentioned going to a course, And I talked to Stanhope when he came back after when I was doing the interview with him, it froze up and I had to say goodbye to him. But then he came back and we had like a 20-minute conversation.
Yeah,
and I asked him about, because a lot of people I know here, comics, I know a lot of comics on where I live on Long Island, New York, and they teach comedy. And I said, and I've always said, and you know, I asked Stanhope, can comedy be taught? And his answer was, fuck no, you can't teach somebody to be funny. You can't teach somebody to be funny. What comedy courses do for people is generally help them define their act and refine their act. But if you're not funny, you can't learn to be funny in a course. So were there people that went, and I don't want to put you on the spot here, are people who went through the course with you who just were not funny and shouldn't have been in there and were expecting to learn to be funny?
Yeah, definitely. There was about, I think on the initial meet, there was about, what was the figure? Just shy of 100 people that turned up or something stupid. It was crazy. But then they did say, they said, naturally, there's going to be a depletion of people. The end product of when we was in the Glee was about 30 or 28 comics left. Even out of those 28, there was a few. I wouldn't name anyone, but there was a few that just weren't funny at all, and they didn't get many laughs in the Glee Club. But you know, they gave it all. It was for a good cause,
right,
and they gave a lot of bollocks to it. There was one comic in particular who we've got like a group going between me and some of the comics who decided to stay together and help each other out getting gigs and this, that, and other, and someone kept making a few jokes about one of the other guys who done the comedy with us in the Glee Club based on how ungood his performance was, let's say. Took it to the extreme, so we just decided, you know, we just don't want to be around people who's just going to completely just run other people down, and we just went our own separate way, you know? So that person then decided that when they kick us out of the Facebook group, I could kick everyone out of the Facebook group, and then we start our own. But it's just too much negativity from that one individual about one person's bad performance.
Right.
But it's
comics are very clicky. They hang out, and I don't say that in a bad way. Sometimes those clicks can be really fun. If you get in a group of comics who really enjoy each other and support each other, that can be a great thing. And to go out to dinner or go to the diner after a show with a bunch of comics who get along and really just, you know, are there to support each other, but also trying to crack each other up, that can be one of the most fun experiences of my life. Have you had that experience yet where, you know, after a show, a bunch of comics hanging out, or before a show in the green room, a bunch of comics hanging out where you say, you know, this is my new tribe. These are the guys I hang out with now.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. As I said, it's quite a few of us from the course we did, who've decided to stick together. And we meet up just something, and we'll stay around for like an hour or so afterwards. And we click, you know. It's, there are times where you can say some bad twisted shit for a laugh that you probably wouldn't even stay on stage, you know. It's great fun, you know. You have a bit of food and you have a lot to drink and you do some other stuff, and it's great.
Over here lately, I've heard a lot of controversy about comedians stealing other comedians' jokes, and it's a big issue over here. Joke stealing, joke theft, and some big names have been involved in it. And it's surprising when you go, is that an issue over there with comics? Do they worry about, you know, guys stealing my shit?
I haven't come across anyone yet who said, that's my fucking joke. He just fucking heard me say that, or you heard me say that a few weeks ago, and he's turned it into his own thing. I haven't been witness to that yet, but I'm sure it does happen, you know? And I haven't met anyone who said that does happen, but it does happen. And yeah, of course it is. I mean, the words, and if a popular topic comes up, and then you tell a joke about it, then I bet someone's gone up a few days later and thought, oh, yeah, this is my joke, and am I going to tell it?
Well, it's kind of a weird thing because, I compare everything to musicians and comedians. In music, you can copyright a song. The idea of a joke not being copyrightable is strange to me because it's very common that we could have the same kind of idea, whether we're, I want to do a joke about atheism, whatever it is, whatever the topic is, you and I can have that same idea. It's when you steal it word for word and the punchline is the same and all that, that it becomes theft. So you should be able to copyright that and say, you know, this is my joke. It's not jokes, all jokes about atheism. It's a joke that starts out like this, goes here, and ends with the boom over here. Here's the punchline. If you take that exactly as it is and use it as your own, that's theft, intellectual property theft. But comics don't have that. I don't understand that.
Yeah, I fucking agree completely. It should be the way. Same way, I suppose, when you're writing a screenplay or something, you know, you write the words and you write the material, and then you do what you want to do with it at some point. But ultimately, you've written that information out, so therefore you should own the shit that you do write, you know?
You got your own bartender working.
Yeah, she does okay now and again. She's thank you very much.
I know
they know the measurements. They got.
I noticed you didn't tip her.
Yeah, she's 13 years of age. She's had enough tips, and I'm gonna be tipping her for the rest of my life. So she owes me. So
All righty then.
I agree. I think you should be able to copyright what you write down. I mean, you don't own the words, but you own the structure and the way that you put the words together, you know?
Right. There's a guy named Carlos Mencia who he's kind of been outed by Joe Rogan pretty big.
Gonna fucking mention that. I was just gonna say, have you seen that? I remember the guy's name, but I was gonna say Rogan brought him up, but
he actually did a 15-minute piece that Bill Cosby did. It was Bill Cosby's material. He did a 15-minute piece verbatim. The bit about the guy at the football game. His father teaches him everything, or his whole life teaches him everything about football. And then when he gets the trophy and he gets his big moment on TV, hi, Mom, or thanks, Mom, and that kind of stuff. And he did that exact bit verbatim on national television. It's like, are you going to think that nobody realizes that that's Bill Cosby's material? Everybody's heard it a million times, but he had no shame in that kind of stuff and did it. And there are so many guys who were really successful who got caught up in that stealing bit stuff. And it shocked me. It really shocked me. I know Robin Williams was big known for that. But the thing with Robin Williams was, he would often write a check to the guy he stole a joke from. He would go home and write a check, go to and send him. I know I stole your bit, but here's a few $1,000. Maybe it'll make you feel better.
Shit, I didn't know that about Robin Williams because he's one of the comics that my father sort of got me into. But again, mainly when I was younger through the films Mrs. Doubtfire, Aladdin, and the like. I got into his stand up a little bit then a bit later on. But I didn't know he was caught up in all that fucking mess. Really?
Yeah. So what's the comedy club scene like where you are? Cardiff? Is there a lot of comedy clubs to work at? Here it's slimmed down. Years ago, where I live, Long Island is a suburb of New York, we used to have 30 or 40 clubs in this area. Now it's down to 3 or 4.
As far as I know, there's not a lot of comedy clubs per se, but there's a lot of bars and restaurants restaurants that will do comedy nights, you've got a few comedy clubs, and then you've got a lot of just pubs, bars, restaurants that will say every other Wednesday, we're gonna do this, it's gonna be a comedy night. And don't get me wrong, a lot of people know of these venues and they attract a lot of them attract big crowds as well. One of the places I've done a few times is a Caribbean restaurant as well. And most of the time it's more comics there than it is actually audience members, and it's an amazing, beautiful restaurant. It's absolutely phenomenal. The guy, I don't know if he owns it or not, but he certainly works there. He's a really good host. He'll come over, he'll give you a free can of Red Stripe, proper like Jamaican beer, and he'll give you some like goat curry. And it's a little stage. On this stage it's got like an old piano, it's got like an old guitar and an old rocking chair as well. That's what the place is called. I just remember the rocking chair.
Great,
And the first time I did a gig there, went to work the next day, they were like, oh yeah, what was it like in the rocking chair? I said, it's great, it's just really cool place. I says, all black dudes and middle-aged pissed up white women just drinking wine from the bottle. But it was nice. Everyone is welcome there, they're friendly, it's a nice group of people.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of pop-up comedy stores, let's say, like that. You know, there's a few comedy bars, as they said, but primarily that's your lot in Cardiff. But it's a big boom. It's a renaissance period for comedy in South Wales, or especially Cardiff at the moment anyway.
Good for them, because you know what? I hate the fact that comedy clubs and comedy venues in general have slimmed down where I am, and the opportunities for new comics are less than they were. But here's the thing that I noticed, which is goddamn stupid, is they'll try to put a comic in on a music show. And that's the roughest thing for a comedian to do. A band's been playing for an hour and a half. People been up and dancing. The bar is noisy now. People when the band takes a break, people are talking and it's loud. And the comedian gets up there and has to do comedy to a disinterested group of people who are just waiting for the band to come on again. It's like, that's not a way to do comedy, man. And so because the comedy clubs have shut down, there's still some... a lot of comedians who are looking for work, they'll take that kind of work. I think it does a disservice to the art form. It really does.
Yeah, of course. There's a lot of, I mean, I say a lot of, there's been a few times where me and a few of the guys have done gigs whereby there's people eating food and there's kids there as well. But the MC rapidly makes sure those kids toddle on home, you know? But at the moment, it's a case of obviously getting a gig wherever you can get a gig, especially when you're a new comic, like myself and a few of my friends. We done back in December, I want to say. Yeah, December. We done a charity gig in Swansea. Again, it's another city. It's a bit further away from Cardiff as to where I am. But it was a charity gig, and people had to spend, £20 a ticket, and it was a sit-down shindig, and they had kids doing a song and dance, and the idea was the kids were going to do a song and dance up until like 8 p.m. and then they were going to go home, and then there was going to be adults only, then it was going to be comics on. But naturally parents, couldn't handle their fucking kids and kept drinking, which is fine, that's what I do too. But they kept making an announcement saying, look guys, it's gone 8 o'clock, the first comic is going to be on anytime now, so just preparing you. We've seen some of the material from these guys. You've still got kids, yeah? You know, sign a disclaimer. First comic goes up, and she's just really smutty and filth in a really good way. And it was like, oh, my God, my kids are here. But that continued. They didn't leave. They kept the kids there. They kept going on and on and on. And then my turn came up then. There's a lot of kids still fucking running around. So I said, right, it's gone 10:30, 10:45, something like that. So I said, if your kids are still here now, they're old enough to know that there is no Father Christmas and there is no Easter Bunny and there's no Tooth Fairy. And then a lot of people started to grab their coats and then take their kids, and it sort of shut down from there. But well, fuck it, it's whatever. Young kids too.
You just ruined Easter for me, man. There's no bunny.
It's not a bunny, but there's a big talking iPad which gives out thoughts to you.
Well, I've been waiting for that bunny for years and years now. I'm so excited. Now you just totally fucking ruined it for me.
He's got fucking rabies and COVID, so he don't even know. He's diabetic. He's not giving out eggs anymore. So it's
My band has a goofy old song that I've written, which is one of the most popular songs. But it has the F-bomb in it, and basically it's making fun of redneck culture in this country, and basically do you want to get naked in the back of my truck? Come on, baby, let's fuck. And nice. We played that at a Republican fundraiser once. The singer in the band insisted that we do it. And there are families with kids and stuff there. And I'm like, dude, we shouldn't play this here. No, it's okay. Because we stop. When he goes to say fuck, I usually stop him and say, hey, wait a minute, bud. You can't say that here. And it's kind of that joke. It's like the baby fell out of the window. I thought his head would split, but luck was with him that morning. He fell in a bucket of shaving cream. You know, that kind of...
Nice. Send me that song later. I'll listen to that one.
he insisted we played it, and we didn't even get through like the first chorus. And the women, the white women Republicans, came running up. You can't play that in it. And then we got so much flack from it. And the guy who was running for office, who was was doing the thing came over and like shaking his head, like, what's with you guys? What were you thinking? Like, it's not me, it's him. I would never play that song. So there's a line and a place for every kind of art form, and you should never mix families with adult humor and that kind of stuff. So.
Just touching up what you said then about part of the song about a baby falling and landing in a bucket of cream.
Yeah.
It is what I remember doing a gig before, and the MC she was telling stories. I think they were jokes. I don't know, but she was telling about a time one of her kids fell out of a cot and then fell out the window and whatever. So she called me up then after she told that little bit about what happened to her kids. So I said, yeah, you should tell that joke to Eric Clapton. I'm sure you'll find that really funny. But she looked at me like I was scum. I was like, you told the fucking story, which is not even a joke, it's a true story. I'm just making a joke of it, and you're looking at me like I'm a fucking scumbag.
Well, Stanhope's latest special that just came out has 13 minutes on dead kids, dead kid humor. And my conversation ended with him telling me, because I had a son who died from a battle, with heroin overdose. It is what it is. It's part of life. But he ended the conversation with me. He goes, "Here's to you and your dead fucking kid." Like, but he said it as a joke. How many people can actually say that as a joke and come from the and mean it? And so there was a piece somebody wrote to him on Twitter that said, "Thanks to Doug Stanhope for making, light of my child's death in a way that nobody else could, and made me feel good about it and laugh about something that was a horrible experience to me." And I think that's what people really don't understand about and why humor gets so divisionary, because people don't understand that shut that dog up.
nice reference.
It's meant to make people, feel good about a bad situation. And of course, we're not really laughing at your dead kid. We're laughing about the human condition and all that goes along with death and dying and whatever is part of your misery, and trying to take you out of that misery.
But that's what goes back full circle to what I said about Frankie Boyle, who said, "What is it about comedy that brings out the fucking worst in people?"
And it's hard to understand why people just can't appreciate a joke for a joke. It really is troubling. But it's good to see that you are rising above that and kind of modeling yourself after those guys who don't really give a shit.
Yeah, fucking right. Yeah, stick it to them. Fuck them.
Yeah, right. We're coming up on an hour here. I want to know, first of all, at this point, you've been doing it for a year, and I don't want to go into the whole story because I do it so many times. I bore the fuck out of people. There's a story, a reason why I asked this question. And the question is, do you feel like you're living the dream?
Yes.
Ooh.
I got to say that because, my wife and kids in the next room, but I'm hurting inside. I am at the moment. I'm not living the dream. I think I'm striding through life as is at the moment. I got a full-time job, which I fucking hate, but it pays well. I got a roof to keep over the heads of my wife and my kids. That aspect of my life is great. I'd be living the dream, I think, if I could do something that I loved full-time, i.e. stand-up comedy.
Right.
But I don't think anyone's living the fucking dream, really. I don't know. What about you? You living the dream?
Let me tell you the story now. I didn't want to tell the story, but I have to because I have to give some context to it. I was buying an amp off of Craigslist. I don't know if you have Craigslist over there, but it's...
I know
So I was buying an amp off it, and the guy told me to meet him in a mall parking lot. I got there early just to check him out because I was like, why am I not coming to your house? I'm buying something that really needs to be plugged in, whatever. So I got there early, and he pulled up in an SUV that was really expensive. He was covered in, he had a diamond watch with diamonds all around it, and he smelled like money. His wife was with him. She was covered in diamonds and pearls. They both smelled like money. And we got to talking, and he asked what I did. I said, I play in a band. And he said, oh, you're living the dream. And I looked at him and laughed in his face, not to be rude, but it was just a natural reaction. I said, you don't understand. I'm a bar level musician, a club level musician. I play beaches and parties, and I'm not a rock star. I'm not rich and famous. He said, let me tell you something. I spent my whole life in the commodities exchange market. I got very wealthy. I always wanted to play in a band. I'm selling you my amp. Now I'm retiring. Means I'm never going to play in a band. You're living my dream. And I went, wow, that fucking changed my perspective in a heartbeat. So I started to do a film about it and kind of show what the life is really like for anybody in the creative arts. But it did change my perspective on, I sometimes I have to take a day job to make things work and all that stuff and you know, family and bills and stuff. But at the end of the day, there are a lot of people who wish they were me and got to live my life. So I want to show people what the work they don't see that goes in behind the scenes and all that stuff. But the whole idea of what living a dream, you never know until you walk in somebody else's shoes what their life is like. So somebody who is rich and famous, rich and extremely wealthy, which is something I covet in a way, was looking at me and saying, I'm living the dream. And I'm looking at him saying, wow, I'd like to live in his shoes for a day. And so we both had that. And it was just fascinating to me. So I've been asking everybody who's in the creative arts, are you living the dream? Just to get different perspectives from people, which is why I asked you that.
It's a good question to ask. But then I suppose to answer the question again, now you put context on the meaning behind it with our story, which I think is a fucking great story, by the way. I think before I done stand-up comedy, I used to doodle stuff down as in little, I say jokes, then they weren't jokes, I used to doodle stuff down. And I did nothing, really. I had no really big hobbies or interests. I'd see my friends and family now and again, but it was work, home, you know, eat, sleep, shit, wake up, rinse, repeat, and the like. But this last year or so, I suppose based on what you just said, I suppose you could say then, I am living the dream if that's what it is.
It's having a passion taking action to move towards it rather than just counting your time here, spending 60, 70 years, whatever we get, and then clocking out and being dead. And all you have to really show your legacy of your life is just your kids. And if you're lucky enough to have kids, and some people don't even have that. So it's like going to a job and just punching the clock every day. You put in your 8 hours, 10 hours, whatever it is, punch the clock, and then you have nothing to show for it at the end of your life. And I think chasing something creative, not even creativity in the arts necessarily, it could be anything. If you have a passion about it, you want to build something, a legacy. I think that's what the meaning of living the dream is really all about.
Yeah, understood. That's like I said, that fucking story is a good one. I like that at all. Yeah, it's really good.
Well, Jamie, I'm glad I got to know you, and I'm glad we had this hour together. I hope after the COVID stuff is gone over there and you're back working, we can do some. Have you back on and promote whatever shows you got coming up and stuff.
Yeah,
and we could just kind of try to find some shit to laugh about together for a short time on while we have it and so I wish you a lot of success moving forward, and I'm glad you found something to be passionate about, and I thank you for coming on.
Yeah, thanks, brother. Thanks for the opportunity to be on the podcast. But in a couple of weeks or months, however long it is, I'll come back in this fucking podcast. It's been really good. Yeah, it's been fantastic.
Excellent. Thanks a lot. I will send you the links as soon as this is up. I'm going to air this tonight on Facebook and YouTube so people will actually see it, and they'll think it's live at 8 p.m. my time. I'm sure you'll be sleeping by then because it's like 2 o'clock in the morning for you or 1 o'clock, whatever it is.
Yeah.
Early
in the morning.
But I'll send you the link to the audio podcast too, so you can kind of, review it and see if you like it and where it came out, and maybe share it with your friends or whatever.
Yeah, bro, man. I'll push your podcast on this end as well. Yeah.
All right. Glad to know you, my friend. Thanks for coming.
You too. Take it easy. Have a good one.
Yep. Bye. Jamie Dykes, people, all the way from Wales, which you probably, if you're in the US, you probably didn't even know was not part of England. It actually touches England. I actually, until I did a little research on it, I thought it was an island, or like Ireland is off of the coast of England. It actually touches England, which I was not aware of. It's actually, like you said, it's a two or three hour drive from London, which is something I learned. And again, that's part of our our culture here in the U.S. is just being stupid about these things, geography, cultures, and all that kind of stuff. And we are so self-centered on what happens here that we don't really pay attention to the rest of the world. And there are some great comics in the U.K., Scotland particularly. I think, you know, more Scottish comedians that really, you know, are doing some really great work in comedy right now. But it was a great pleasure to have Jamie on. I hope you enjoyed this program. I hope you'll, I'm going to put his link to the Glee Club performance that's on here, and maybe we'll get some more from him, and I will link to all his stuff. I hope you'll check him out and support him. Get to know him over here and maybe spread the word. And I will also put links to his Facebook page if you want to check out some of his comedy there, or just keep tracks on him and see what he's up to. Maybe add him as a friend, whatever. I hope you enjoy this podcast. I hope you tell your friends about it. Subscribe. Go to the YouTube channel. Subscribe there. Go to minddog.com. Get on my mailing list. And, oh, yeah, here's the other thing. And you know you've been slacking. Go to Apple Podcasts and leave me a good review there. Because we started out like gangbusters with the good reviews, and now you're slacking off, and you're letting me down. I want to see some good reviews this week. And if I don't, there's going to be hell to pay. No more free T-shirts. Well, I don't know. There will still be free T-shirts. But just leave me a good review. So with that said, until next time, which is tomorrow, I'm Matt Napo for the Mind Dog TV podcast. Bye for now.
I'm broken and I'm shattered glass. I know you think I'm just an ass, but if you look beneath my scars, you'll find that I'm just like you are. For all the shit that we've been through, I love you 'cause you're broken too. I'm broken and I'm beaten down. I know you think I'm just a clown, a damaged and a mangled mess, 'cause I can't see that I've been blessed. Inside of me, inside of you, I love you 'cause you're broken too. I could die alone, but give a dog a bone. He's loyal and he's always true. I'm broken and I'm bleeding too. I know you take me for a fool. I am without a shred of pride, wounded from a trust that died. I love you 'cause you're broken too. I'm broken but I'm not destroyed. I know you think my heart's a toy, behaving like a reckless child. You hide behind a devil's smile, but when my dying day is through, I'll love you 'cause you're broken too. I love you 'cause you're broken.
I love mind dog. I love you. I love having the dog be the best friend of my mind.